Good day, future LPPs. Our Jaguar welcome to the first episode of our science majorship lecture in this channel. Allow me to introduce myself. I am Janlo G. Adlaon. I am a licensed professional teacher and a lecturer here in Bohol. In this lecture, we're going to use English and Tagalog as our medium of speaking so that wider people can understand us. So just bear with me when I speak Tagalog because sometimes my Tagalog sounds like Bisaya. Anyways, we're not here for my accent, but we're here to learn. All right. So I graduate Bachelor of Secondary Education, major in Science at Bohol Island State University. Okay, just here in Bohol. Okay, I got my license last March, I think that's March 2023. Okay, yes, March 2023. I am part of the first batch of the K-12 curriculum who take the licensure examination for teachers. And by the grace of God, I got a good rating. I got 91% in my majorship. Glory to God. All right. So before we'll start, I want to know if all of you are ready. All right. If you're ready, you can comment or you can like our video for today. All right. Okay. All right. So please grab your notebook, your pencil or ball pen, so that you can take down notes while we are having our lecture for today. All right, according to Edgar Dale's cone of experience, 10% of what we read will be remembered. 20% of what we hear will be remembered. 30% of what we see. Okay, 30% of what we see will be remembered. And then 50% of what we see and hear will be remembered. And then 70% of what we say, okay, again, 70% of what we say and write will be remembered. And then finally, 90% of what we do will be remembered. So it's up to you. You can do your learning style. You can utilize what's your forte as way of learning. All right, let's start. What is science? Okay, as a science major, okay, have you tried to encounter somebody and then asked you, what is science? Huh? Yes, I myself always encounter this from my friends or from my classmates. They just randomly ask me these things, what is science? And I just answered straightforward, science is a systematic pursuit of knowledge or a systematized body of knowledge. Well, that's correct and that's right. But the word science brings so many pictures, okay? When we hear the word science, we can think of a laptop, a computer, a cell phone, a vehicle, a table, so many things that is related to science. But none of these pictures can give the full idea or full picture of what really science is, because science has many facets. It has many facets. When we say science, it is a way of discovering the universe. It is a way of discovering the universe and how these things work today, right? How these things work today, in the past, and how they will work in the future. Okay, it is a human effort of understanding the nature of the world, okay? The nature of the world and the different work that is accompanied with the nature of the world. Okay? By simple terms, it is a way of understanding the universe in a systematic way. Okay, now when we say systematic, it follows a procedure. It follows a method. Okay, it uses a scientific method. Now, what is scientific method? All right, when we say scientific method, it is a process of objectively establishing facts based on testing and experimentation. Again, when we say scientific method, it is a process of establishing facts based on testing and experimentation. Now, we have here the different processes in scientific method. It starts with a phenomenon or an event. Okay? When we say phenomenon, these are the things that are happening in the society. Okay? The current event that we are facing in the society. And next, we have identifying the problem. Let's say, for example, before the internet came, or before our cell phone games came, one of the problems is how can we communicate our loved ones from far places or from different provinces, from different area of the country or of the world. That's why, due to the demand of the society, the scientists have created or invented the phone, okay, or the internet, so that we can connect to our loved ones that is far from us. Okay? So that is identifying the problem. Next, identifying the problem is hypothesis. When we say hypothesis, that is an educated guess. Yes, you're right. That is an educated guess. And we have two types, the null and alternative. Okay, the null and alternative. When we say null, okay, everybody say null. All right. When we say null, that is a statement of no effect or no difference. Again, when we say null, that is a statement of no effect or no difference. In contrary, when we say alternative, that is a statement of effect or difference. Okay, meaning to say we assume that there is an effect or there is a difference between the variables. Alright. Okay, next to hypothesis is the experimentation. Okay, everybody say experimentation. Alright, yes, that is when we utilized different equipments so that we can use to test our hypothesis. Okay, to test our hypothesis. And in the experimentation, we have the so-called empirical approach. Okay, when we say empirical approach, that is based on experience, based on testing, or based on experience. When we say experience, we use our senses. We have sight, smell, taste, hear, and touch. But of course, it must depend on what substance or what things we are studying. Let's say, for example, you are studying acid. Can you use a sense of taste for that? Of course, no. All right? So in experimentation also, we have the so-called validity and reliability. Okay, I assume that you already have a background of what is valid and what is reliable. But now we are going to have a review of them. When we say valid, I want you to remember this. When we say valid, that is measuring what it intends to measure. Measuring what we intend to measure. Okay? Just remember, when we say valid, it measures what it intends to measure. Now, how will we know if our experimentation is valid? That is if The result of our experiment corresponds to the established theories or concept related to what we have studied. Okay, how can we know if our experimentation is valid? If, okay, it corresponds with the established theories and concept related to our study. Now, let's proceed to reliability. When we say reliability, that is the consistency of our measurement. Okay? That is the consistency of our measurement. Let's say, for example, let's do an experiment with the effect of a certain molluscicide that we experiment to kill mollusks. Okay? So when we say reliability, okay, that means the result, okay, the result of our experimentation today will be the same when we repeat it tomorrow and the next day. So that is reliability. Again, for validity, that is, what's validity? Okay, you can say that your experimentation is valid when, okay, the result of your experiment corresponds to the established theories and concepts related to your study. And when we say reliability, that is the consistency of the measurement or consistency of the result. Next to experimentation is gathering and analyzing data. Okay, in this time, in this process of scientific method, you are gonna tabulate, okay, data that you get from your experimentation, and then you are gonna analyze them using tables and interpret your table. And then after that, you can draw your conclusion. Now, most of the people would say that it ends in the conclusion, but always take note that in scientific method, it does not end in conclusion. You have to what? You have to communicate your conclusion, or you have to publish your conclusion, because that's the prime reason why we do study, or why we do experiments, or why we invent. That is for the good of the society. Okay, now how can we contribute to the society when we will just keep the result of our study? Well, in the first place, we do it so that we can contribute to the benefit of the society. Alright, so that is the scientific method. Now, let's proceed to biology. What is biology? Okay, it is a branch of natural science. The word biology comes from the Greek word bios and logos. Okay, bios means life and logos means study. So meaning to say, it is the study of life. Okay, in general, biology is the study of the structure, the composition, the characteristics, the function, and classification of living things. Okay, again, of living things. Okay, that is biology. Who is the father of biology? Yes, he is Aristotle. The father of biology is Aristotle. All right, now let's talk about the different branches of biology, and let's start with anatomy. When we say anatomy, that is the internal structure of living things. Everybody say internal structures of living things. Okay, it talks about where can we find our heart, our brain, our liver. Okay, it talks about our structure, internal structure. Okay, now when we say physiology, that is the functions of the structure. Okay, take note the difference between anatomy and physiology. For anatomy, just talk on the structure. But when we say physiology, it is the functions of structures. Okay, Take note of that. Now, when we say botany, that is the study of plants. Botany is the study of plants. Cytology, yes, study of cell. Next, ecology, relationship between living and non-living. Okay, or the relationship between biotic and abiotic. Alright. Next, we have genetics. Alright. Genetics is the study of heredity. When we say heredity, that talks about how traits is being passed from one generation to another, from parent to offspring. Okay. Father of genetics. Okay, Gregor Mendel. Phylogeny. When we say phylogeny, that is evolutionary history of organism. Evolutionary history of organism. Pathology. Study of diseases. Endocrinology. Study of hormones. Zoology. Study of animals. Alright. We also have entomology. Study of insects. Ornithology, study of birds. Taxonomy, the science of classification. Okay, father of modern taxonomy, si Carolus Linnaeus or Carl Linnaeus. Alright. Okay, identify, classify, and name organism. That is for taxonomy. Paleontology. Paleontology is the study of fossils. Ichthyology. Ichthyology is the study of fishes. Again, ichthyology is the study of fishes. Alright. Are you familiar na? Do you familiarize the different branches of biology? Okay, I hope that you have taken down your notes for that so that you can review it. Next, let's talk about the famous personalities and their contributions in the field of biology. Okay, are you familiar with the different scientists in biology? Okay, let's start with Thales of Miletus. Thales of Miletus is the father of natural philosophy. Okay, he is the father of natural philosophy. He is a pre-Socratic philosopher, okay, from Miletus in Ionia, Asia Minor. Again, he is a pre-Socratic philosopher in Miletus of Ionia, Asia Minor. Okay, he is a father of natural philosophy. Okay, he specializes in nature. Okay, it encompasses the nature, how it works in the past. Okay? Because during his time, the modern science has not yet emerged. Okay? They just do their observation on the nature. Okay? That is Thales of Miletus, father of natural philosophy. Next, Aristotle. Okay, Aristotle is the father of biology. He classified living things as plants or animals. Father of classical taxonomy. Okay, he is the father of classical taxonomy. Okay, don't get confused. Modern taxonomy is Carolus Linnaeus. For classical taxonomy, Aristotle. Alright. Okay. Next. Carolus Linnaeus. He is a Swedish botanist, zoologist, taxonomist, and physician. Father of modern taxonomy. Next, Anton van Leeuwenhoek. He is the father of microbiology. Okay, he is the first scientist to observe microorganism with the use of microscope. Okay, when we observe small organisms or microorganisms in his microscope, he called it animalcules. Okay, animalcules. Next, Gregor Mendel, father of genetics. Theophrastus, father of plant science. Charles Darwin, he is the proponent of the natural selection theory. His famous book was On the Origin of the Species. Edward Jenner, smallpox vaccine. Okay, everybody say smallpox vaccine. Okay, who discovered? Edward Jenner. Next, Alexander Fleming. He discovered penicillin. Okay, he discovered penicillin. Okay, so the discovery of penicillin was kanang it was discovery by accident. Okay, that is for Alexander Fleming, because one time in London, when Alexander Fleming was about to take a vacation, okay, he forgot to put the dish where he cultured Staphylococcus, a type of bacteria, for him to study. He forgot to put it in the incubator. And then, after days of his vacation, when he came back, he observed that there is a certain region in the dish where there is no bacteria found. Okay, there is no bacteria found. And that is when he realized that a certain fungus causes it to happen. And that is the Penicillium notatum. Again, Penicillium notatum. That's the name of the fungus. And that's how Alexander Fleming discovered penicillin. Okay. Next, serendipity. That is, serendipity means discovery by luck. Okay. Next, Claude Ephraim Zubel, or Claude Zubel. He's the father of marine microbiology. Okay, he's the father of marine microbiology. Next, William Whewell. He coined the term scientists. Again, William Whewell coined the term scientist. Okay. Now let's talk about the structures of living organisms. Okay, the living organism is classified into two. We have unicellular and multicellular. Okay, when we say unicellular, okay, from the prefix uni, that means one or singular. These are organisms that exist as a singular independent cell. Example for unicellular organism is bacteria. Now, when we say multicellular, these are organisms that exist as specialized group of cells. Again, multicellular organisms that exist as specialized group of cells. For example, human, cat, dog, like that. All right. Now we will talk about the types of the cell. Okay? There are two types of cell. We have the prokaryote and eukaryote. When we say prokaryote, that is with nuclear material in the center of the cell, but no nuclear membrane, no membrane-bound organelles, and bacteria, a blue-green algae or blue-green bacteria is an example of prokaryote. Okay, just think of it. When we say prokaryotes, they are unicellular. Okay, they are the bacteria. So when we say bacteria, they don't have membrane-bound organelles. They don't have nucleus. Okay, they don't have nuclear membrane. When we say eukaryotes, they are multicellular. Okay, they have definite nucleus and a membrane-bound organelles. Example, plants, animals, fungi, and protists. All right. Now let's have cross section of an animal cell and plant cell. Okay, let's differentiate this two types of cell. All right. So what did you observe? Okay, we can observe here in this image that the vacuole in the plant cell is bigger than the animal cell. Another. All right, we can also found chloroplast in the plant cell. Okay, we can find chloroplast in the plant cell. Okay, another. All right, we have here the cell wall. The cell wall of the plant cell. All right. What do you call the cell wall of the plant cell? They are called cellulose. All right. How about the bacteria? Okay, it's called peptidoglycan. Again, for the bacteria, it's called peptidoglycan. For the cell wall of the plant, it's called cellulose. All right. Now, let's talk about the cell organelles. Okay, are you familiar with the cell organelles? All right, let's start with the chloroplast. When we say chloroplast, it is an organelle of the plant. Okay, it is an organelle of the plant cell. It captures light for photosynthesis. It is present in the plant cells and algae. Okay, when a certain organism has chloroplast, that means they are able to undergo photosynthesis. Okay, photosynthesis. Next, Golgi body. They package and distribute products. Okay, my style during the time when I was a reviewee, I think of Golgi body as GNT Express or Food Panda or Flash Express. Okay, they are the ones that delivers, package and deliver. Okay, so that's the work of Golgi body, package and then distribute products. Next, lysosomes. Everybody say lysosomes. They digest excess products and food particles. Okay, they are like the janitors of the cell. Okay, they clean excess products. They consume excess products. All right. Next, mitochondria. Powerhouse of the cell. This is where the production of ATP takes place. Nucleus. Nucleus is found at the, yes, at the center of the cell. This is where we can find the DNA, which controls cellular activities. Okay, next, ribosomes. Okay, when we say ribosome, the function of ribosome is production of proteins. Production of protein. This is where translation takes place. Next, vacuole is the storage of the cell. Okay, this is where substances is stored. Next, plasma membrane or cell membrane. It is a phospholipid bilayer. It controls transport and maintain homeostasis or equilibrium or balance in the cell. Okay, so I compare cell membrane to a guard of the school, the guard. So the guard will allow who will come in and who will come out of the school. The same function with the cell membrane. Now, cell wall. When we say cell wall, that is a rigid second layer that protects and encloses the cell. And cell wall is present in plant cell and bacteria. I already mentioned it earlier that in plant cell, it is called cellulose and in bacteria, it is called peptidoglycan. Alright. Next, cytoplasm. Cytoplasm is a fluid-like substance that contains organelles. So just think of it this way. Cytoplasm is like a blood in the human body. So in our human body, we have different organs, right? And our organs is embedded in our blood. Okay? Now, in the cellular level, the different organelles is embedded in the cytoplasm. Okay? Don't get me wrong, ha? Cytoplasm is different from blood. But they have the same function. Okay? Cytoplasm is where organelles are embedded. And then blood is where our organs are embedded. Now, next, we have the endoplasmic reticulum, or our ER. This is the site of chemical reactions. We have the rough ER and smooth ER. The function of rough ER is to produce proteins because it contains ribosome. Okay, and smooth ER for lipid production. Cytoskeleton. Everybody say cytoskeleton. It provides internal structure of the cell. When we compare it to our human body, it's like the skeleton. Alright. Cytoskeleton contains microfilaments and microtubules. So when we say microfilaments, these are fibers. Okay, and microfilaments contains actin protein. Okay, microfilaments again contains actin protein. Microtubules, these are cylinders which contains tubulin protein. Again, microtubules contains tubulin protein. Alright, now let's talk about the cell theory. Now, who can remember or recall the proponent of cell theory? The proponent of cell theory is Schwann and Schleiden. Okay? Schwann and Schleiden. Yes, you're right. Schwann and Schleiden. Alright. The cell theory is the cell is the basic unit of life. Okay? According to the cell theory, the cell is the basic unit of life. That means without cell, life is not possible. Okay, by the way, who first discovered cell? Who first discovered cell? Yes, you're right. He is Robert Hooke. Okay, next, all organisms are composed of cells. Okay, according to the cell theory, all organisms are composed of cells. And then third, all cells come from pre-existing cells. Again, all cells come from pre-existing cells. That means cells are able to divide. Okay, and what do we call that? Cellular division. Okay, which is categorized into two, the mitosis and meiosis. Okay. But let's not dwell on that topic for now. Alright. Now let's talk about the cell transport. Okay. When we say cell transport, that is when the different particles or substance in the cell is being transported or being transferred from one place to another. Now it is categorized into two. We have the passive transport and active transport. Now let's tackle first about the passive transport. When we say passive transport, that is the movement of substances across the plasma membrane without the use of the cell's energy, with the concentration gradient high to low concentration. Just think of it this way. When we say passive transport, that means no energy is required. Okay, no energy is required. Okay, think of you at the top of the hill. Okay? Think of you at the top of a hill. When you go down from the top to the bottom of the hill, that is passive transport. And when you go up from the bottom to the top of the hill, that is active transport. Now, here's the idea. From the passive transport, you don't need more energy. You don't need energy. So, think of it this way. Which is harder, going up a hill or going down the hill? Of course, going up the hill, because you need more energy for you to resist the gravity. Alright? You need more energy to resist the gravity para makaakyat sa taas ng bundok. You need more energy. But when you go down, okay, you can just go with the flow. Okay? Or you need lesser energy when going down a hill. The same thing in the passive transport and active transport. In the passive transport, you don't need cellular energy. And active transport needs cellular energy. Okay, take note ha, passive transport with concentration gradient, high to low concentration. Alright, different types of passive transport. Okay, we have diffusion, osmosis, and facilitated transport. Let's start with diffusion. When we say diffusion, that is the movement of substances across the membrane following concentration gradient. Okay, that is when the particles move across the membrane. Okay, in the cell. Diba? In the cell, we have the membrane. When the particle passes, okay, move across the membrane. Let's say, for example, this is the membrane of the cell. When the particle just passes or move across the membrane following a concentration gradient from high concentration to low concentration, that is diffusion. Okay? Now, when we say osmosis, osmosis is a diffusion of water. Okay? And diffusion is, the diffusion talks about the movement of substance or particles. However, osmosis is the movement of water or diffusion of water across the membrane following a concentration gradient from high concentration to low concentration. Okay, but in terms of solute, it follows from a lower concentration of solute to higher concentration of solute. However, when we talk about the concentration gradient, it is from higher concentration gradient to lower concentration gradient. Because that's the most of the confusion of most of my students. Don't be confused. Osmosis, that is the movement of water across the membrane. Okay, from higher concentration to lower concentration. Now, let's proceed to facilitated transport or facilitated diffusion. A carrier molecule embedded in the plasma membrane transports substances across the plasma membrane following the high to low concentration gradient. So, parang the same lang siya sa diffusion. It's just the same with diffusion. However, in the facilitated diffusion, there is a protein membrane. Okay, there is a plasma membrane that helps the movement of particles, that aids the movement of substances. Okay, nakuha? Okay, that's the difference between the diffusion and facilitated diffusion. Alright, let's proceed to active transport. Everybody say active transport. Alright, when we say active transport, that is the movement of substances across the plasma membrane using, take note, using cells energy and carrier molecule. Again, using cells, energy, and carrier molecules. Substances are moving from an area of low concentration to an area of higher concentration. Okay, it is the other way around of the passive transport. Alright, so it is classified into two, which is endocytosis and exocytosis. When we say endocytosis, that is the large particles are brought into the cell. Okay, Okay, large particles brought into the cell. And it is, endocytosis is classified into two. That is the phagocytosis and pinocytosis. Phagocytosis, that is when the cell engulf solid particles. Again, when the cell engulf solid particles. Alright, phagocytosis engulf solid particles. Pinocytosis engulf or ingest fluid. Okay, pinocytosis engulf or ingest fluid or liquid. Phago solid, pino liquid or fluid. Alright, let's proceed to exocytosis. Okay, from the prefix exo, which means outside. Okay, large particles leave the cell. Okay, kuha. Okay, very good. Now, let's proceed to the tonicity. Okay, when we say tonicity, that is the ability of extracellular substance to let the water content of the cell go into or outside the cell. Okay, it is categorized into three. Hypotonic, hypertonic, and isotonic. Okay, when we say hypotonic, more of the water molecule is inside the cell. Okay, more of the water molecule is inside the cell. Alright. And when that happens, the cell will burst and swell. And in the hypertonic, water molecule inside the cell moves out, which makes lesser molecule content inside the cell. Okay, and when that happens, the cell will shrink or shrivel. For isotonic, the water molecule inside and outside the cell is just balance. Okay, it's just balance. All right. Okay, so it's just same size for the isotonic. Now, let's talk about bioenergetics. What is bioenergetics? That is the study of energy in living systems, the environment, and the organisms, plants, and animals that utilize them. So, it's just talk on how living things or consume energy, or how we utilize energy that we get from the environment. That is bioenergetics. Okay. Energy. Energy is required by all organisms. Again, energy is required by all organisms. Okay, for us human, we need we need nutrients from the food that we take, okay, in order to have energy. And for the plants, yes, the plant needs solar energy. Okay, it needs solar energy so that they can undergo photosynthesis. Cellular energy is ATP, that is the energy currency of the cell. ATP stands for adenosine triphosphate. Very good. ATP stands for adenosine triphosphate. Okay. Okay, this time let's talk about the characteristics of life. Okay. What is life? Okay, when we say life, you will have this characteristic. next. Now we have here HOMGAR. Okay, everybody say HOMGAR. Okay, HOMGAR stands for homeostasis, organization, metabolism, growth and development, adaptation, reproduction, and response to stimulus. Okay, let's have talk about them. So when we say homeostasis, that is the ability of an organism to achieve equilibrium or balance. Okay, let's say for example, do you know why you get sweat? Okay, bakit tayo pinagpapawisan kapag mainit ang lugar? Okay, why do we get sweat when the environment is hotter? Okay, that is the mechanism of our body to achieve balance in terms of temperature inside and outside our body. Okay, see to see na when the environment is hot, we produce sweat. And sweat is liquid. And this liquid allows your body to what? It allows your body to cool down. Okay, it allows your body to cool down so that your internal temperature, the internal temperature of your body and the environment will be balanced. Okay, will be balanced. So that is homeostasis. Now when we say organization, everybody say organization. When we say organization, just think of the levels of biological organization. Familiar na? Alright, what are the levels of biological organization? Okay, let's start with atom. When you combine atom, you can form? Okay, very good. You can form molecule. Okay, out of molecule, you can have cell. Group of cell, you call it tissue. Group of tissue, you can call it organ. Group of organ, you can call it organ system. Group of organ system, you can call it organism. Okay. And then next to organism is population. Now, when we say population, that is group of individuals of the same species. Okay. When we say population, that is group of individuals of the same species. Next to population is community. Okay, community. When we say community, they are the group of population in the same habitat. Okay, again, when we say community, they are the group of population living in the same habitat. Next to community is ecosystem. Everybody say ecosystem. Okay, we already mentioned it earlier. Ecosystem is the relationship between living things and non-living things, or the abiotic and the biotic relationship. Okay, next to ecosystem. Okay, next to ecosystem is biome. This is a larger way to classify organism according to classify the biological organization, I mean, according to the type of organisms that live in a particular place, the type of place, and the type of temperature. Okay, type of temperature, type of living things that survive to that environment. Example of biome is tundra, taiga, okay, tropical rainforest. Okay, so that is for the biome. Next to biome is the biosphere. Okay, lahat na. Biosphere. Alright, that is for organization. Now, let's proceed to metabolism. Okay, when we say metabolism, that is, yes, that is the process. Okay, the process inside our body. Okay, how we consume energy. Okay, that is metabolism. And in metabolism, it is classified into two. We have anabolism and catabolism. Okay, for anabolism, you just remember this word, build up. Okay, anabolism, build up. Catabolism, breakdown. Anabolism, build up. Catabolism, breakdown. Okay, example of catabolism, digestion, chewing of food. Okay, that is for catabolism. For anabolism, the building up. Okay, anything as long as it build up particles. So that is anabolism. Example, you build fats. Okay, in your body, that is anabolism. Okay, next, growth and development. When we say growth, that is the change in size. Okay, and when we say development, it talks about changes in behavior. Okay, changes in behavior. When we say growth, that is quantity. It is measurable. When we say development, it's a quality. Let's say, for example, your attitude, your trait, that is growth and development. And that's the difference between growth and development. Okay, next is adaptation. When we say adaptation, that is the ability of an organism to fit to the condition of the environment. Again, when we say adaptation, that is the ability of an organism to fit to the condition of the environment for survival. Okay, that is why when you go to a certain place, you need to adapt to the environment so that you can survive. And that is one characteristic of life. Next is reproduction. Okay, for reproduction, that is classified into two. That is sexual reproduction and asexual reproduction. Okay, sexual reproduction involves the sex cells, the union of sperm cell and egg cell. Okay, in human, fertilization occurs in the oviduct or the fallopian tube. Okay, again, sexual reproduction involves union of sperm cell and egg cell. Now, let's talk about asexual reproduction. We have here five classification: budding, binary fission, fragmentation, regeneration, and parthenogenesis. Okay, let's start with budding. When we say budding, that is outgrowth. Okay, just write outgrowth. When we say budding, that is outgrowth. Let's say, for example, I am a certain organism. And then, one time, there is something, okay, that there is something that grows in my shoulder, at the top of my shoulder. Okay, that is outgrowth. It just, I formed buds. Okay, example of an organism capable for budding is Hydra and yeast. Next is binary fission, split into two. Okay, example for organism capable for binary fission is bacteria. They are going to divide itself in order to reproduce. Next is fragmentation. Okay, when we say fragmentation, just think of the root word fragment. Okay, it is break parent cell into many parts. When you break the parent cell into many parts, it can form many different organisms. Let's say, for example, for planaria, when you're gonna cut the planaria into one planaria into three, you will have three planarias. Okay, do you wish to have that capability, class? Jaguars, would you like to have that? Fragmentation, you just cut yourself and then you reproduce. Yes, planaria is capable for that. Next is regeneration. Capable of regrowing certain parts. Okay, capable of regrowing certain parts. Example, lizard and starfish. Okay, do not get confused with budding and regeneration. For budding, When there is an outgrowth that is a new organism. Okay? And in regeneration, when there is something that grow that is just a part of the organism. Okay? So, example sa regeneration is lizard and starfish. However, starfish is also capable for fragmentation. Okay. Next is parthenogenesis. So, parthenogenesis is that is a reproduction without the use of sperm cell. Okay? Without the use of sperm cell. The development of an egg without the union of sperm cell. Okay. Capable for parthenogenesis is the bee. Okay. So, next is response to stimulus. Okay. Next is response to stimulus. When we say response to stimulus, that is how we react with the stimulus. When we say stimuli or stimulus, that is the causing agent. Okay, what caused you to react like this or like that? That is stimulus. When we say response, that is your reaction towards the stimulus. Now, it is classified into two, different from animal and different from plants. Okay, let's go first with animals. For animals, it's called taxis. Okay, the way animals respond to stimulus is called taxis. Okay, let's say when animals is drawn towards light, okay, towards the direction of light, that is called as phototaxis. Okay, animal drawn towards the stimulus chemicals, that is called chemotaxis. Okay, on the other hand, when we say plant, it's called tropism. Again, when it talks about plant, it calls tropism. Okay, and it's classified into two, negative tropism and positive tropism. When we say positive tropism, that is towards the stimulus. Okay, and negative tropism, that is away from the stimulus. Alright, let's say for example, you place your plant at your window, and then after a week you observe that the leaves of the plant moves outside the window towards the light. So what do you call that? Positive phototropism. It's called positive phototropism because it is drawn towards the stimulus, which is the light. Okay, that is for the response to stimulus. All right, did you learn something, class? Or jaguars? I'm sorry, I'm just used to speaking inside the class. That's why sometimes I called you class. Okay, but for our group, for our channel here, you are called jaguars. Yes, you are jaguars. Okay, did you learn something today? Okay, I hope so. So the board exam, the licensure examination for teachers is really fast approaching, and I can feel the pressure, your pressure. Okay, I know that you've got a lot of pressure, but always remember that you are not alone. God is always with you, and God will never leave you nor forsake you. Just fight the good fight. And when you get tired, always remember that this is not just your fight. This is the fight of you and your loved ones, your family, okay? Your parents is rooting on you, so do not give up. All right. For the rest of the time, you still have more than a month to prepare for the licensure examination for teachers. And I just hope that you use your time properly. Do not waste your time as much as possible. you do so many drills, you answer many questions. Okay, we provided here a lot of drills in this channel for you to answer. You can answer that. And also, expect more lecture videos to come. Okay, we will tackle different concepts in science, okay, which is related to the given TOS of the PRC for this coming licensure examination for teacher. So, that's it for now. Thank you for listening. God bless and keep fighting future LPTs. I'm here. I'm just here cheering for you, my Jaguars. Thank you and see you next episode of our lecture. God bless.